So I'll just, a small disclaimer. So, Arvind said, ask me a lot of tough questions. But if you do ask me a lot of tough questions, then I have to actually deflect them to a colleague of mine who handles Qualcomm Ventures. So, he's the guy who will take all the tough questions. And all the easy questions can come my way, okay? So remember, easy questions to the person on the stage. Okay, so guys, I think the other reason why I'm in a spot naturally, because I'm here at in a session that is sitting right between all the great sessions that you've had all day today and the party you're gonna have. Okay, so now I think Arvind asked a question. Did you guys all have a great time? Let me ask you the following question: are you all hoping to have a great time at the party today? Okay. Who's going to the party, by the way? Okay, that's good. I mean, I see a few hands which may not raise, so I would request them, they should listen to their next door neighbors. Okay, so guys, I will not take a lot of your time, but what I wanted to do today, and in fact, Arvind mentioned, it may be something interesting for the audience here, is to talk about some of the trends which are essentially shaping the wireless industry right now. And believe me, guys, I mean, this is an extremely exciting time to be in this industry, to be, associated with any part of the ecosystem, especially the developer ecosystem. And, at the end of the presentation, hopefully, you will feel, the excitement and, maybe shake a couple of more legs at the party, okay? Just a quick snapshot of Qualcomm. We are actually one of the world's largest fabless companies. So we don't actually manufacture our own chips. We design the whole chips and they get fabricated with our partners. And we have 25 years in the business. We are now over 15,000 employees worldwide. We have a large presence in India as well, in Hyderabad, Bangalore, where we have our R&D centers, and then relatively smaller business offices in Mumbai and Delhi. Now, Qualcomm, we've been powering a broad variety of devices. In terms of our chipsets, they are essentially going into very entry-level devices, let's say 2,500 rupees devices, all the way up to, the super smartphones, or super phones, as these days are called, the dual core, phones. And of course the tablets. What we do at Qualcomm is we spend a lot of time in integration, and that's actually our core strength. We work on integrating all the cool technologies, which typically tend to be separate chipsets. We tend to integrate them into single chipsets. So that's what we do, whether it's across the connectivity part or the CPU, multimedia, etc. And we do all this while focusing on the battery life. So we have some of the most power efficient processors. Okay, and just to if there are questions on what is Qualcomm doing in an Android developer conference? I mean, Qualcomm actually has been associated with Android for many years. In fact, we are one of the founding members of the Open Handset Alliance. And we've been working very closely with Google for several years. When the first Android came out, anyone remember the HTC Dream here? The first Android device which was launched. Okay, does anyone know the operator that launched this? Okay, I think you guys are completely covered here. Okay, then we also went on to work on the first 1 gigahertz phone, the Google Nexus One. Anyone here can tell me which operator Nexus One was launched with? Okay, that was a trick question, because as I think you may know, Google actually launched that phone directly. An open market handset, as we call it. Right, and then recently we also launched the world's first 1.5 gigahertz Android with KT or Korea Telecom. Okay, so. So that's a little bit about Qualcomm. Now let me actually take you a little bit into the trends that I mentioned, and just take you down a trip journey which hopefully, you know, you will find exciting, because as I mentioned earlier, this is an exciting time. So what is happening? I mean, clearly, the mobile has established itself as the biggest platform or technological or communication platform in the history of mankind. Right now, more specifically, if you look at the broadband side of things, you know, again, you know, mobile as a broadband platform has, you know, essentially, you know, being the dominant platform for, you know, people to connect on the go, you know, in a, and get a broadband experience. And, you know, these are just some numbers here, you know, which I'm, you know, quoting from, you know, these are public numbers, but, you know, clearly show the trend on how fast, you know, these are 3G subscriptions, by the way. And as I think in a market like India, this is very relevant because the phone is also the first computer for a lot of us. In fact, you know, you will hear a lot of anecdotal references to, you know, the first internet experience is, you know, of many Indians is on the phone. Well, that's true, and it's also because it's the first computer for many, many people in India and other emerging regions. Now, guys, please pay attention to the numbers, because I'll be asking these numbers at the end, okay? And whoever can answer them will get a super dual gigahertz phone. Okay, actually, forget about the dual gigahertz, just remember the numbers, okay? So what is enabling this transformation, you know, the transformation of, you know, the phone into the computer? So, you know, there are some, you know, multiple different trends that are actually all coming together to, you know, form what we call the perfect storm of opportunity. So it's on the device side, on the network side, and on the application services side. So I'll cover, you know, all these three, you know, in a bit of, you know, give a glimpse into, you know, all these three aspects. Let's look at the network part first. You know, it's interesting. So in, you know, world over, I mean, you've seen the large shift happen on 3G and, you know, 4G, LTE networks are getting deployed, you know, widely. And, you know, really, if you look at the way at least the industry is viewing, you know, these multiple technologies at the moment and how they coexist, it's, you know, really about, you know, the 3G, you know, spreading across the you know, the large regions in terms of the cities and the towns and moving out. The LTE deployments are actually, you know, happening at very, you know, high traffic areas or hotspots and slowly moving out. And of course, you know, the underlying 2G technology, you know, the 2G networks are, you know, very, very widespread. And, you know, what this is doing is it's creating the opportunity for, or in fact, creating the market for devices which can actually seamlessly go between these networks. Because you know, you don't want to have a device where, you know, you go from, you know, your central business district out to your home and suddenly you lose connectivity, or, you know, you move further out, you know, on your weekend drive and, you know, you can't connect. So, you know, clearly multi-mode devices, you know, are needed, and in fact, you know, that's where a lot of innovation is happening right now. Now, India is not far behind, as I think most of you know. You know, in terms of the 3G networks, all the major operators in India have deployed 3G networks, and in fact, we've deployed a more advanced version of 3G called HSPA, you know, which can give speeds of up to 21 megabits per second. You may be hearing, you know, some of the, or you may be seeing some of the advertisements in the television. So guys, for a change, those television ads are not false. They are actually accurate. Along with 3G, you know, the CDMA guys have actually expanded their EVDO networks, and EVDO essentially also offers a broadband experience. And, you know, that's, you know, covering the large part of the India today in terms of, you know, the geographies. And last but not the least, LTE, you know, the network launches, you know, are just waiting to happen. As you know, the spectrum for that has already been allocated. There are a lot of trials going on. Some of the companies have already announced the trials. So the day is not far behind, you know, in fact, when you will see the LTE networks also on the ground. And the scenario of, you know, having 3G, LTE, 2G, you know, coexisting in this market. So again, you know, some very interesting things that are happening. Now let's shift gears a little bit to the devices side. So I think this probably should come as no surprise to anyone here, but clearly the smartphone adoption is growing very fast. In fact, as a percentage of total shipments globally, smartphones are expected to cross 50% in 2012, and you know, go up to almost 85 to 90% by 2015. Now, that's all top level data. But what is happening within smartphones? I think what is very relevant for the audience here is that I think you are in very safe hands with Android. If there was one takeaway from this chart, I mean, clearly Android as a share of the total smartphone market will dominate this year. So 2011, it's it's going to dominate. In fact, the latest shipments say that Android shipments in the last quarter have exceeded 50% of all smartphone shipments, right? And you can see the trend continuing through 2015. Now, so that's on the smartphone side. Now, what's actually happening inside these smartphones? There's an high level of integration which is going on at the at the silicon level or at the chip level. So you see a lot of these things here, and these used to be disparate components either in software or in hardware, but they are all coming together to create very highly integrated chipsets which can support these technologies, these various technologies on the phone. So just taking a few examples here, I think the ability to run HLOS like Android, that's definitely there. But also things like the GPU or graphic processing units, the sensors, the high multimedia capabilities, connectivity across a bunch of things, not only Bluetooth, Wi-Fi, near, the near distance ones, but also the wide area connectivity, right? So that's, getting integration or driving integration, essentially leading to devices which are getting smaller, more powerful, and at the same time, battery efficient. And cheaper, by the way, the most important point. So just a quick chart on how the computing power is increasing. And you can see, these are, these numbers actually are getting close to what used to be in laptops, right? I mean, not too, many years ago. So, in 2012, for instance, you will essentially have, over, 10 to 15,000, DMEPs, in the phones. Typically, and these, when I say these numbers are more, more mass market. I'm not talking about like the one or two phones which launch, but essentially phones launching in volumes, which is what you as developers care about, right? Because you're clearly not looking at, an opportunity where it's just one device here or, two devices there. And along with all the computing power, there's a lot of, innovation happening on the multimedia side. So again, taking some examples from this chart, on the graphics side, you have 3D acceleration, of graphics, of animations, of videos, happening. You have video audio encoders at full HD capabilities. You have high definition audio, SRS, Dolby, also getting integrated into the chipset level. So you can essentially now, how many people here use do applications that essentially play audio on the phone? How many guys do that? Okay, I think they're quite a bit. But which are the most common kind of formats that you've used in the past? Do I hear MP3 here or AAC or something like that? Well, now you can do full Dolby stereo or SRS stereo on the devices now. Right? Isn't that pretty cool? I mean, think about the effect that you can generate when you plug in a headphone and you have Dolby 5.1 playing through the phone. Moving to camera, I'll talk about this a little bit later, but again, some very interesting things happening. The capabilities of cameras in terms of taking the images and processing them, you know, for, you know, things like facial recognition or gesture recognition. I mean, there's some tremendous, you know, amount of innovation happening here, which, you know, open up, you know, just a sea of possibilities for, or use cases for developers to tap into, right? And, you know, things like GPS, not to mention. So all this, you know, what is it leading to? It's actually leading to the ability to create some extremely rich and powerful applications for developers, and especially for Android developers. You know, and the reason I say, you know, it's for Android is because a lot of these technologies are coming onto the phones, and you know, there are tools and technologies being made available for Android developers to, you know, use and tap into these capabilities, you know, at the chip level. So, so let me go into, you know, let me cover some of these topics in a little more detail. So things like, and these applications, by the way, I mean, all these possibilities, you know, they can be developed today. So let's look at what can be done today. So things like video optimization, you know, you run a standard video, you know, at, let's say, you know, 360p or, you know, 720p, but you can actually now, you know, directly tap into the hardware, you know, decoders or the DSPs for, you know, 1080p. Things like, you know, DRM, you know, there are hooks being built into the silicon for you to use advanced forms of DRM. Now, you know, there's an interesting use case here. You know, when Netflix, I think all of you must be familiar with Netflix. So they've been doing high definition streaming to the PC. And, you know, when they wanted to do high definition streaming to the phones, they realized that the DRM capability of the phones, you know, were not enough to, you know, give, you know, encryption or protection to high definition content. So Netflix actually worked with Qualcomm and, you know, to build this capability into the chipset. So essentially the Play DRM or the Playwright DRM technology, you know, was extended to take advantage or, you know, to make use of what Netflix required. And, you know, and the Netflix, you know, first implementation of its high definition streaming onto the phone was, you know, delivered on a phone which was powered by Snapdragon, an LG device. Graphics, you know, GPU, you know, there are tools available to tap into the GPUs directly for, you know, people who do gaming. How many game developers here? Okay, that's a really small number. But, you know, gaming, as I think you guys all know, is, you know, is a very large segment in terms of the, you know, the market and the applications which are out there. So, you know, again, the ability to tap into, you know, some serious 3D graphics to get to what we call console quality gaming. I talked a little bit about facial processing. You know, there are tools available by which you can actually tap into a, you know, the camera's input and in fact use it to track facial or gesture movements. And, you know, imagine the use cases that can be, you know, generated. I mean, you walk into a room and, you know, you may not know a lot of people in the room, but now suddenly because of facial recognition, you know, your phone actually is able to, you know, take the facial, you know, not only the expressions but the features into an application, and the application is able to tell you, you know, who that person is, and, you know, what they do, and, you know, which department they are in, and, you know, all that. So, you know, imagine the kind of interactivity that you can build in. Peer-to-peer. Peer-to-peer is another interesting area where there's, you know, a lot of innovation happening. So clearly, you know, there are applications that exist, you know, which do multiplayer gaming over the 3G networks and soon 4G networks. But has anyone here tried to create peer-to-peer games or peer-to-peer applications of any nature using, say, Bluetooth or Wi-Fi? Has anyone done it? Okay, there are a few hands, okay. So, I mean, tell me, honestly, is it difficult or is it hard?
I developed with iOS, so it was pretty easy. They develop a iOS GameKit kind of framework, which actually works with Bluetooth and the local Wi-Fi. So, I don't know much about Android, particularly on peer-to-peer.
Okay, so you did it on iOS. So let me tell you that there is actually a framework available for Android called AllJoin. And so AllJoin is an open source project which essentially allows applications to become Bluetooth or Wi-Fi agnostic. And the framework takes care of most of the things that are difficult to do for developers when they do peer-to-peer. So all the things like pairing, discovery, security when you do peer-to-peer, all those things are taken care of by the AllJoin framework that runs on the phone, and you can create Android applications on top. So if you go to I'll actually point you guys to this link, developer.qualcomm.com, where there are there's a ton of information and links to all the various tools and technologies that I referred to on this chart. So I would highly encourage you guys to check it out, especially this peer-to-peer, because that's extremely unique. There are some applications that you can download as well, some sample applications. Now I'll just spend a minute on augmented reality, because this is an area which is right now, there's a lot of not only interest in this area by developers, but also there's a lot of work that's happening in this space. So typically, I think you guys are familiar with what's called compass-based or GPS-based augmented reality. So applications like the Lear browser or Wikitude, they rely on the position of the phone and the orientation of the phone to essentially determine what content it needs to fetch. Now, this is it's easier to do, it's not very accurate, because you are relying on the external sensors or the sensors on the phone. Now there is a whole industry revolving around something called vision-based AR, which essentially relies on, so the difference between the previous one and vision-based AR is that vision-based AR relies on the input from the camera. So, you can now take the real world image from the camera and you can do things. And, in this example, as you can see, the bee, which is the Honey Nut Cheerios bee, is actually being rendered, right next to the box. So this kind of accuracy actually requires, a lot of processing, power to be available on the phones. But guess what? That power already is being made available to you. So, you can create vision-based AR applications, pretty easily now. And, where these applications present, or, can take your existing applications to a new level, or, lead you to create new applications. So things like, games, social networks, there's a lot of use cases in retailing and merchandising. Like in this one, the Honey Nut Cheerios example. Another interesting example I'll tell you about is, what the NBA in the US did. So NBA, one of the teams said, Dallas Mavericks, what they decided to do is, they wanted to use AR to, engage the people who were actually coming to the games. So they were seeing that, people were coming to the games, but, they were coming, they would watch the game, but would not be very engaged with the franchisee, in terms of buying merchandise and all those things. So what they did is they created an AR application which required the user to point their camera to the Mavericks ticket. So everyone who went to the game got a ticket, right? Now what the guys needed to do is, what the users need to do is point their camera to the ticket, and the ticket actually became a basketball court. And they could actually shoot hoops and select their favorite characters from that team and shoot hoops on that ticket, right? So imagine something as dull as a ticket suddenly comes alive, and they could take that home and continue to play the game and engage with them, and essentially buy their merchandise, get more information about the players and so forth, right? So that's an example on how vision-based AR was used in an interesting scenario. So, just some concluding remarks here. I think the opportunity is there. What I call the smart platform opportunity. I mean, there is, as I mentioned in my presentation. There are a lot of interesting things that are, you know, happening at the device level, at the technology, at the network level. The piece where I think, you know, this audience can really fill in is on the applications and services. So guys, you know, this is really a question for you. The opportunity is there, the framework, the infrastructure is there. How soon will you grab this? So thank you. So now, just a quick, by show of hands, just wanted to get a sense, how many developers here are actually serving or making developing applications exclusively for like the, you know, the markets in the West or, you know, non-India markets? Okay, that's, I would say maybe more than half. And how many are also focused on the India market in terms of locally relevant applications? Okay, that's interesting. It's almost a similar ratio. Okay, how many exclusively on India market? Okay, that's very interesting. That's great. So again, the, you know, if you have some interesting ideas on some of the applications you want to create, do reach out to me. You know, I'm fairly easy to reach, and you know, again, you know, I can lose the shirt anytime, so don't worry about the shirt part. But you know, reach out to me. My contact details. Let me just bring up my. So that's my email ID. So, you know, any ideas you have or thoughts on, you know, on any of the things that I talked about or need more information, do check out developer.qualcomm.com. And if you have any questions, you know, please reach out. So thanks, guys. Have a great party. And hope this was, you know, entertaining. I'm sorry I did not, you know, go into the source code level, but hopefully, you know, you guys found this useful. Yeah, I can take some questions if there are. Yes. And no, again, remember the first rule. All hard questions to the gentleman over there. No, just kidding. Please go ahead.
The question is like the whole presentation you brought about smartphones. But I think another section is growing is tablets. And they are getting too powerful. What's your thought on that?
Yeah, actually, maybe my presentation may have seemed a little biased towards smartphones, but I mean, clearly, I mean, everything that, you know, that I talked about in terms of, you know, the new technologies that are coming up, either on the network side or on the, you know, on the processing side, some of the other technologies that are getting integrated, they apply equally to tablets. In fact, I mean, my belief is that, you know, in a lot of markets like India, tablet will be viewed first as a computing device and then as a communication device. So, you know, in fact, so a lot of this will be even more relevant to tablets. But yeah, this is all available in tablets. So, you know, next time you pick up a tablet, don't lose heart.
Thank you. Content protection, one of the slides.
Yes.
Can you elaborate on that?
Yes. So content protection, you know, essentially relates to some of the DRM implementations that, you know, are being done by, you know, a lot of the silicon vendors, including Qualcomm, you know, to be able to run, you know, some types of DRMs in real time. Like, you know, so imagine if you're like streaming, right? And you're streaming at, say, 30 frames per second. Being able to, you know, unlock the content or unlock the DRM protection on that stream requires, you know, extra bit of efforts on the device. And, you know, all of that cannot be done simply, you know, just by the CPU. So there are, you know, technologies which are getting into the phones, you know, which are offloading that capability into more specialized cores, you know, which do the, you know, essentially manage the DRM on the device.
Hi. Great presentation. The numbers look really amazing. Thank you for that. A quick question. So one of your slides contained a box called 3D web pages, or, you know, you're seeing that in the future there will be applications like 3D web pages. Could you just talk about an example? Is that going to be different from AR, or is that going to be an extension?
No, in fact, you know, the 3D web pages is an extremely unique use case, and in fact, a different use case. I mean, it actually relates a lot to what is happening in HTML5. So, you know, as you know, the way HTML5 is evolving, it is now, you know, it's possible to run a lot of the graphics that you essentially, you know, have on a page and you run it on the device. And what is also happening, which is interesting, is that a lot of this rendering of the graphics, which is happening inside the HTML page, is now being offloaded to 3D engines and GPUs. So I take an example of Google Maps. I mean, Google Maps, the if you actually now try out Google Maps on a lot of devices, Google Maps, by the way, is a good example of HTML5 because it's it's exclusively HTML5. Only when you go into like the entry level devices, that's where they may have more of an app component, but it's mostly built on an HTML5 framework. A lot of the rendering, the things that you see when the maps actually rotate and you can like zoom in, zoom out, it all is happening in the by the processor or by the GPU inside the page.
So you said that thing that you work. You work with the Netflix to get the DRM working, right? Is it specific to Qualcomm processors, or have you made it like generic enough for other processors to also do it? Because I can't distribute an app assuming that everybody will have Qualcomm process, right?
So that's a good question, and the simple answer to one of the questions that you asked is it being made available to all the processors? So we are certainly not making it available.
I was saying more like are you making like you have this OpenCL, right? So OpenCL is still like API level, and every GPU can implement it according to the specification. Implementation will still be specific to that. Are you making it like that other processor implementers can do it, or are you just is specific to Qualcomm?
No, so if you see some of the DRM technologies, right, I mean, they are open. They are not specific or proprietary DRM technologies. What we've done is, we've done the implementations, the early implementation in the case of Netflix. Because Netflix, wanted to use, Play DRM for, being able to do HD content DRM. So, we did the early implementation, but it's, it's not, something that we would hold, as a technology. It's an open technology.
Hi. How do you look at competition from TI and ARM in this space in the future?
Well, competition is good, right? Competition is what makes us all go around, or is that makes the world go around. So we think certainly the competitors we have they are doing good things on maybe one or two things, right? So there is typically in an integrated silicon or integrated chipset level, there is the whole computing part and all the technologies that are getting in, and the connectivity part. So there are companies that are doing very well, say on the just on the computing part or just on the connectivity part. But what we believe is that, and the market actually is buying into this, is that to offer like a true broadband experience, if you will, right? I mean, today when you buy a laptop or when you buy, let's say, a PC, the broadband and the computing part, I mean, they are usually together. I mean, you hardly have a case where you just look at your computer for the computing sake and forget about the internet or the broadband side of things. So we believe the integration actually is what is interesting, and that's where we actually hope to be the leaders, or we hope to maintain our leadership.
My question is related to AR. I was wondering that Qualcomm was coming up with an SDK for AR, augmented reality. I wanted to know whether what's the case with that. I heard about it that Qualcomm was coming with an SDK for augmented reality. I just wanted to know what the status is.
No, thank you for asking that question. Because I think in my presentation I may have missed that. But yes, we actually have an augmented reality SDK for Android developers. And we believe this is it's an industry-leading SDK. It makes creating the vision-based AR type of applications extremely easy, And especially, you know, if you guys do a lot of, you know, animations using, you know, engines like Unity, for example, you know, it actually, it's the whole experience of creating some pretty powerful augmented reality applications, you know, is very, very simple. So yes, the SDK is available. If you go to developer.qualcomm.com, you'll find a link to augmented reality and you can download the SDK. We support Android devices 2.1 and higher. So that's actually an example, I think, to going back to the earlier gentleman's question on, you know, whether we are holding things to our chest or, you know, making them more open. So the augmented reality application actually is available for Android. It'll work on any Android phone. But we believe that, you know, the performance that you get in terms of, you know, the high rate of tracking objects onto the vision that you're capturing is best done on the Qualcomm platforms.
Can you hear me?
Yeah. Oh, there you are. Hi.
So you had a slide about 1 GHz, 1.5 GHz. So it, to me, it looks like this is how that laptops were in 2001, 2002, and today most of us don't know what are the exact GHz. So when do you see that trend reaching the mobile sector where GPUs, your GHz don't really matter, or it's kind of flattened out?
So that's an interesting question, and you know, in fact, I think it's anybody's guess really. I mean, clearly, at this moment, I think it's, you know, 1 GHz is kind of, you know, we are very close, you know, quickly approaching 1 GHz as a benchmark. In fact, you know, as I, you know, mentioned in my presentation, next year you will see 1 GHz becoming more and more mainstream. I think we have ways to go before, you know, we hit that, you know, that ceiling where, you know, the consumers, you know, say that, oh, you know what, I mean, let's say my phone is 2.5 GHz times 4 cores, right? 10 GHz of total power. I mean, you know, it's, I don't care, you know, everything, you know, works just perfectly, you know, so. But I, you know, but I also believe that the way, you know, I mean, if you look at the way that mobile technology has been, you know, developing and evolving, I mean, it's, you can clearly see the projection is, or the trajectory is much faster than, you know, what has been seen. I mean, you know, just to give you an example, I mean, we are talking about 1 GHz. You know, it's not too long ago when, you know, most of the phones were typically 150 megahertz. You know, we are talking about gigahertz, 150 megahertz. It's already come like 10 times and now, you know, 20 times, you know, in the last 2 years. Right? So it's still early days, but again, it's anyone's guess. Okay, guys, so thank you very much again for your time, and I really hope that you have a great rest of the evening at the party. The guys who did not raise their hands when I asked the question earlier, you know, hopefully I can see their hands now. Will you guys go to the party now? Okay, I see some hands. Okay, at least I helped. So I mean, you should be happy. Thank you, guys.